I'm the shark, and these are my deep waters, and you're watching the Scottish Wrestling Network podcast.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. This week, I am joined by the manliest man in pro wrestling, the street rat, the hobo, the king of the streets, and other excellent nicknames, monikers. It's Manlon. Welcome to the show.
Hiya, Paul. Thanks for having me.
I'm glad we finally got to chat, because of after BT shenanigans in previous attempt. But I can't get away without asking the most boring question, but it's the icebreaker. How did you get into pro wrestling?
I'm trying to think. Like, honestly, I think it was probably video games that got me into wrestling, because my first ever console was a Super Nintendo. It was a hand-me-down from some family member. And one of the games in that was Royal Rumble for the SNES, which is a terrible game. Like, it's not aged well at all. But I just kind of started with that, and then it went from, eventually it was in, you know, getting videos out of Global Video, and then like, you know, just started watching pay-per-views, and it just went from there. So yeah, I think I'm one of the only people who can say their fandom actually started with, you know, Crush.
You probably are one of the few. So was it like a bit of a weird thing, like playing the game and then seeing it's like, oh, these guys are actually real? Or were you kind of aware of wrestling before the game, or the kind of come hand in hand?
I don't know. I think it was always something that I was kind of aware of. Like, I was very young when I first played it, so I don't know if it's, you know. But yeah, it's like I've, as long as I can remember, I've always just, you know, watched wrestling or had some interest in it, you know. But I remember my fandom especially exploded around like SmackDown 2 specifically.
So a Crush at that point would have been probably one half a Chronic around about then.
Best.
so would that be your favourite era Crush? No, Kona Crush or DOA Penis Tattoo Crush?
Nice nostalgia bits, but I think Chronic's the best one until they went to WWF, but we don't really, you know, talk about that run. WCW Chronic were great.
Yeah, I do remember seeing Chronic on Worldwide on Channel 5. They would pop up every so often. Seeing this big dudes in leather. And it's one of those tag teams that they were just big dudes and they threw you about. Fine, absolutely cool with that. But it's one of those when your parents come in the room, you just go, yeah, they're wearing see-through leather outfits. I don't want to speak about it any further than this, please. but then again, the next guy who come out would be Goldberg, and he'd be bald head and black pants, and I don't know which is worse when it comes to outfits. So how did you go from your big fandom of Crush to actually attempting to be a wrestler yourself and joining Source?
Came at a sort of troubling time in my life, because I'd recently just left college at that point, like the first time around, and I was actually listening to the Art of Wrestling, like Oakman's podcast, and I think that really sort of made it seem feasible to actually get into it, if you know what I mean. Because that was the first time I really, like, I knew that indie wrestling existed. That was the first time I heard about people were actively going from, like, wrestling fans to becoming wrestlers, if you know what I mean. But their experiences, you know. And I just, as an offhand, I was like, I've not got anything else to do right now. I might as well, you know. And I looked up all these schools in Scotland, and Source just happened to be the closest, you know.
And I picked up the wrong notes for you. I'll find them again. There we go. Right. Yes. So, so Source was the closest school for you. Did you do any more research for your trainers? Was it Demo? Wasn't it Demo and Nicky Cross at that
point? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Demo and Nicky Cross. Bombard. Bombard's one of the guys that can actually put a lot of my stuff onto. Like, it's his fault I exist, basically.
So what was like that first? I mean, you've always been quite a slim person, tall but slim. A lot of my issues at the moment have been with tall guys. I've had ADM would be the week before this, and then Colton Davis. So there's all 6 foot
Jesus.
Plus guys, and you're just in that bracket. Am I right? 6'2", something like that.
I'm just under 6'1", but according to wrestling, I'm 6'2". You know how it is.
I know. I was looking up your height on 2K. Well, I made you on 2K20, and I was like, I must be around about 6. That's what I'm thinking, just from photos and reference points. And then I saw 6'2", and I thought, really, 6'2"?
It's because Dame actually told me to go by that height, and then when I started realizing, because in the wrestling, there's not that sort of distance between people. I'm like, people are going to see through that straight away. But because I put it down in our cage match and wrestling wiki, it's only picked up. Don't I know? I'm officially 6'2".
That's fine. Just a tiptoe when you get in the ring, I'll do it. So what was like that first bump then?
It was horrific. But the worst thing was actually doing just like general exercise for the first time, because I'm asthmatic, and being, you know, the kind of nerdy person I am, I didn't really do much sports beforehand. So if anything, it was the first warm up killed me. And then it was the bumps weren't too bad. Like, I was always kind of okay bumps, but it was just general exercise was killing me in the early time, you know.
Yeah, I was my next question is, like, did you have any like sport background, football or anything like that, or was it just
JR would hate me.
I know he wouldn't have ridiculous facts about your collegiate record or anything like that. Yeah, I mean, I know for myself growing up, I did football just because that was the only way to make friends. But in general, when I realised that the internet existed, I just sat on LimeWire at the weekends, LimeWire and any site that I could watch Dark Knight slightly. Not legally. It's a weird thing, thinking that not going from any sport background to actually wrestling. So why? That's the big question. So no sport background, very little exercise or cardio background. Why do you decide to try wrestling instead?
Just because I've always had this big love for wrestling or this, you know, and that a down point in my life. Like, I'm very open about the fact that I have depression and anxiety, stuff like that. And I just figured, why not? You know, like, I've always loved wrestling, and I thought I was only going to do it for like a week or two, and here I am 8 years later, you know? Like, I never thought that I thought I'd do it for a couple of weeks or whatever, just to like, almost say that I had done it, you know? So it was never like a long-term plan, and even then it's, you know, it was always meant to be like, oh, just try it out, see if I enjoy it, you know?
Yeah, it's got that quick rush of serotonin and then just go, right, try the wrestling. What's next? What else can pop up? So like I say, 8 years. So how long did it go from training to actually making your in-ring debut? I'm assuming it was on one of the showcase shows somewhere.
Yeah, it was the first ever showcase when Source was rebranded, be separate from SWA, because at the time Source and SWA were the same thing. And it's only when Source rebranded to be its own sort of thing, that's when, oh, excuse me, we just had dinner. That's when I debuted 18 months after training, after starting. Because I started in August 2012, and I debuted in March 2014. And I debuted purely because I was a comedy guy, and Source didn't have a comedy guy on their sort of roster at the time. Like, they had DCT, but DCT was sort of moving on to be more serious. And they just went, yep, we'll get Manlon in there. But I'll be open, I wasn't ready. I was not ready at all. I was dreadful.
I was just thinking, I mean, I haven't seen the match myself, but 18 months seems to be very quick. From the stories I've heard, some saying that they went in, it took years, took more than a year. Anyway, I think ADM was 3 years before he even got in front of a crowd. So, comedy character, was that just by accident, or was that a conscious decision to be a comedy character?
I don't know. It was a bit of both. Really, like, I'm naturally like, because I like to make people laugh, you know, that's kind of just the thing. So it came from training, just like pop, you know, can I make people laugh or can I pop them, you know? And due to my, how do I say it, limitations at a time, like because I was so skinny, I'm still kind of skinny, but, and I wasn't great wrestling, I could get through stuff by using comedy and using like, you know, so it became like a way just to get through things. And then people actually started reacting to it and training. So then I kept, you know, sort of kept going with it. And it worked for the first wee while, being this purely comedy character. And, like, I understand any popularity I've got is down to most of my comedy stuff or, you know. So there is a place for me, you know, still to do it. But at the time, it's just, I was 100% doing it.
Right, okay. So, yeah, so I was trying to strike a balance as you were training at the same time between doing the comedy and actually throwing in a bit of wrestling in there at the same time.
Yeah. Which I could not do at the start.
Your pink and black attires, that's kind of followed you throughout, even when you went through the hobo stage, which we'll get to. Was that for any reason? Was it just the gear that you came across, or was it a little bit of tribute to Bret Hart or anything like that? What was your reasoning behind your attire?
That gear belonged to Jackie Grady first, because Jackie actually bought a set online that had, it was like bikers with the same design, and I was wrestling up in Reckless. I used to wear Daisy Dukes. I was a huge fan of Stevie Richards, and I was like, oh, 2 seconds. Lily, oi. Lily, 2 seconds.
Sorry.
Hey, yeah, come on.
Sorry, stay a little break while.
There we go. Sorry about that.
That's all right. I thought you said Billy at first. Not, this is a bit weird. But I'm getting shouted at, but it's Willie, of course, which, you know, my nickname at school. So it was. I think it goes by Jetstream Jack now, but it's his gear originally.
Because I was wrestling up in Reckless, and this is maybe my third or fourth match, and he said, you know, these might suit you a bit better than the Daisy Dukes. And I think originally the idea was for us to team together using the gear. Like, we actually shot a wee vignette in the, you know, with that gear together, which that never panned out, but I just loved the gear design. And due to no one else yet wearing a similar colour scheme, I kind of just stuck with it. And for a long time, I was just skint and couldn't afford new gear. But now it's kind of synonymous with me. So,
yeah, absolutely right. You think there would be a bit more, because, well, I mean, I suppose the only other one I can think of that wears pink and black regularly would be Aspen Faith, I suppose. That would be the only other wrestler in Scotland that would wear that colour scheme. Not that exact gear, but that colour scheme, certainly. So it is definitely a rarity. So you said one of your favourites was Stevie Richards. Obviously, he wasn't in the Royal Rumble game, unless he was an unlockable character. So what developed your love for Stevie Richards?
When I was younger, I only had Sky One to watch wrestling on, which had, oh, I can't remember the name of it. I think it was WWF Afterburn or whatever it was called, which was
Jonathan Coachman or something like that.
Yeah, it was like the recap show. And they'd have Heat. And this is about 2002, 2003. So a lot of my stuff came from watching like just the undercard from that time. And one feud that for some reason stuck in my head, I don't remember if it's actually any good, Steve Richards and Test. Don't know why, just one of those things that just stuck with me. And then just because of that, just played Steve Richards in the games. And then when I got a bit more, like when I was actually starting to watch older wrestling, fell in love with the BWO, fell in love with Right to Censor. Hell, even like, you know, the sort of, oh, what was it, the game when I first came into WWE, dressed up as like Dudley Boys, APA, you know?
Yeah, I'm kind of reliving that at the moment through the Cultaholic classic. They do the SmackDown shows, and my first member Steven Richards is Steven Richards, really. That was my first memory of, so just before Right to Censor, and then of course we're back to Chronic again. Don't know if I end up just come back to Chronic and everything. But did you go back and watch a lot of ECW, or was it just a bit more BWO stuff you picked up?
Just like BWO, like another love of mine is death matches, which you know you wouldn't expect from my style of wrestling, but anything like that was really violent to watch, because I remember when I was younger, I didn't ever stop wrestling at one point, but what sort of ignited the love for it again was seeing Sabu versus Abyss in the barbed wire match, the barbed wire massacre, I think it was called, when the, you know, the ropes are.
Yeah, I know what you're on about, yeah.
So, I think that's when my, as I say, extreme levels of fandom really started, was seeing that, and then kind of going from there. But I can't say ECW is not really one of my favourites now, you know, it's good, but I'm much fairly old NWA, that's more my stuff.
All right, so yeah, again, that's another bit of a tangent then, because it wasn't, I mean, they had things like, I'm trying to delve into the NWA knowledge I don't have, but like things like dog collar matches and and that. So they had like ultra-violent stuff that didn't rely heavily on barbed wire and explosions. It was just medley men battering each other.
The thing is, my favourite match ever is, I think it's Starcade 2, I think it is. And it's Tully Blanchard and Magnum TA, the I Quit match inside the cage. My favourite match ever, and it's brutal. Oh, it's...
I've only watched a little bit of Magnum TA, but as soon as I saw him, anytime I see him at all, I'm just like, oh God, I wish that guy didn't have, what was that, a motorcycle accident or something like that?
Something like that, yeah.
That ended his career, because he looked like a star. He just looked huge. He had a bit of charisma about him. He had all the moves, and he's just one of those guys that, I suppose it's the same for like people that see Brody or something like Bruiser Brody, that go, oh, this guy could have made it anywhere, but things happened didn't happen. But Mag TA is just, I guess, just one of those guys I'm kind of enamored by, but I haven't seen enough of his stuff to know why I'm enamored by him, but he's just star. When you see him.
He's great. He's just like everything that a wrestler in that time period should have been, you know? Like, he's absolutely fantastic. And so I think, I know I'm just putting on my sort of, you know, like, couch booker hat or whatever it's called, but him in the Lex Luger role when he was in the Horseman and stuff like that would have been, you know?
Yeah, it's one of those guys. I mean, he's still around, isn't he? But obviously not in a... He doesn't wrestle.
Yeah.
But he's still around. Again, it's one of those feelings that he's just got... I think he's still got something that he could probably put in. Don't know if he's part of NWA now.
I think it's mostly like convention appearances and all that, you know?
I'm sure his line's still long, and it's not like Virgil's at all. So yeah, growing up, so Steven Richards being one of favourites. Any other ones that popped to mind that has been... big favourites, even ones that you went back to and ended up becoming fans of, like Tully and Magnum TA.
At the time, a lot of it was like Kane and Undertaker, because as much as like I love wrestling, my first love's like comic books and stuff like that. And at the time, it's like comic books and cartoons, and seeing characters like Kane and Undertaker who almost look like they've literally jumped out of them, you know. That's what really sort of got me into wrestling a lot, was because, you know, when you're three or four, you don't look at it and go, oh, that worked great, that's really good. So it's big spangly guys and, you know, big spangly suits and stuff like that, or, you know, literally cartoon characters, which Like there's a ton of ones that just stick with me, things like, you know, like Doink, like especially from the gate from like the games, Doink, Shawn Michaels even as a kid. But most of my love as a kid were like was in that sort of 98 to 2001 sort of. That's when I was watching wrestling.
Banging the Attitude Era then.
Yeah, so like Mick Foley, Mick Foley's another one of my favourites, like I think Mick Foley, Stevie Richards, Undertaker when I was younger was my favourite. And as I've got older, I've obviously guys like in the Radicals and stuff like that, you know, like and guys like Crash Holly, ones that weren't maybe as, you know, featured, you know, you get a certain love for.
Just from our brief chat, I've got a feeling that the oddities and the headbangers are probably in there as well. Just pure characters, kind of thing, being up there as well.
Yeah, it was anyone that looked radically different, anyone that acted different. You know, would always stand out to me. So, what's that term? Is it toyetic? You know, when you can look at someone and go, ah, that'd be, you know, yeah, well, I have a toy of him, or you will play, you know, something like that. Mm-hmm. It'd always get my eyes. Like, if I was a kid now, the Fiend would, oh, he'd be my, you know, my guy. Just because that sort of, it's so radically different and stands out.
Oh, yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, even at 30 now, I'm still, like, looking at toys, I'm thinking, I'm 30, I really shouldn't, but kind of want a Fiend action figure because it just looks so mental, and especially this kind of climate of wrestling where everyone's a really good wrestler, but they're all dressed in wrestling gear, and then you see this clown, this kind of morphic
evil clown. Murder clown that's also a TV presenter. It's just so radically different, and that's what makes it stand out so much, you know.
Yeah, in that vein, my first action figure was Draws. And I was drawn to it. I hadn't even seen Draws wrestle, but I was drawn to it because, have you seen Draws? It's just like the plaid shorts and the piercings and the little mohawk thing. And then my second figure was Goldust, which again, it came with a jacket. I was really kind of, I was buying it because it came with a robe because it looked amazing. And then Ken Shamrock was the third one. So it was just like, that's a full remit. Wrestler, one that looks like a wrestler, one that looks totally mental, and then Goldust in the middle somewhere, not even in between. He looked pretty crazy as it was. So characters was your big thing then. And nowadays, is that kind of still the same? Looks like the Fiend being one. Is that kind of the same thought?
Yeah, it's kind of
similar. You're a big fan, Nick Gage. Is that right?
Oh yeah, it's, like I said, anyone that it's the same way. And like even with things like video games and stuff, if someone's got a unique design, the way they carry themselves different, the way they look different, you know, that's what will get my attention, because, you know, it's straight away it's just someone that's different, someone that's like Nick Gage is absolutely fantastic. He's got that connection with the crowd as well, which is, there was a match I watched last year, it was him versus Ricky Shane Page, and I don't think I've ever seen that level of passion from a crowd. Like literally, as Ricky Shane Page is going through, people are throwing drinks at him, sticking, you know, all sorts of vulgar hand signs up at him. And then when Nick Gage threw, you would have thought that, you know, Jesus had just returned. It was something else, you know.
Yeah, certainly the crowd really makes shows, which has made shows at the moment very weird when it comes to no crowd. But go back to starting to watch wrestling. Were you aware of any Scottish wrestling around about that time? So 8 years ago, so that's 2012 is when you started training. That's when I actually started watching Scottish wrestling. So was there any shows that you'd went to previously, like from SWA around about that?
I'd seen some stuff on like YouTube here and there, just randomly googling like Scottish wrestling or whatever, or seeing posters here and there, but I'd never actually done a deep dive into like Scottish wrestling. Like, I knew the ones that appeared on, like I knew McIntyre, obviously, through WWE. And, you know, you hear about ones here and there. But it was only when I went into that deep dive, when I was like, right, I want to go training. So I looked up SWA I seen some PBW and I seen some ICW at the time, but a lot of Scottish wrestling hadn't jumped on the, like, hadn't started putting stuff on YouTube yet, if you know what I mean. Like, it hadn't really sort of started expanding as big as it did.
Yeah, so, I think it took a good, well, 2012 is when I started, so probably 2014, I think that's when it proper went, right, everyone's getting a YouTube channel and showing off what they can do. Mm-hmm. Kind of round about then. So yeah, no, so when you went in and saw Damo and Nikki, you were just like, and Glenda Barr, these are your trainers. You haven't seen them do any of the work themselves.
I'd seen Damo and I think I'd seen Damo and Nikki, because I remember like the month before ICW released a full show. I think it was Insane in the Membrane. And I'd seen them on that, and I think that was literally the only concrete knowledge I knew going into, you know, that.
All right.
Like, I hadn't been anything yet. I'd only seen that show on YouTube and had a couple of, and because I written down some of the names to look up, and then, well, at source, you know, Demo, Nikki, and all that, those names sort of stuck with me. I was like, all right, I know them, or I know of them, you know.
So when you started training, were you in a class? Is there anyone that's still around from when you started in your class to now?
I think, it was a long time ago, I'm trying to think. So I remember when I was late because, you know, getting somewhere for the first time is a nightmare. And the school's actually tucked away in a wee industrial unit. So it took me ages to find it. And then I remember when I was getting changed, there was what's he wrestling? Robbie Wishart, formerly known as Solar, and Xander, like, what's his second name? Xander McGuire, is it?
All right, Govan Team.
Yeah, Govan Team, because I think he trained for a bit with Source and then had some time away and then went with GPWA. But I specifically remember those were the first two people I talked to, because I'd talked to Dave, and then Dave said, oh, go get changed, we'll get some, you know, something sorted out. And I sat and talked with them, just asking them about, you know, what kind of source, what source is like and what training's about and stuff like that. Yeah, they were the first two people I talked to. And in that class, I remember DCT was training and I can't really remember anyone else. Like, there was a lot of people, but again, it was that much of a sort of... I just walked into this because it used to be in a bodybuilder gym. So you walk in and these big Adonis is, you know, lifting weights and shit. Sort of lifting weights, and, you know. And then you go in and there's a wrestling ring and it's full of, you know, big burly wrestlers and all that. And I was just terrified. So I don't really remember everyone that was there. I can just remember going in and coming out and having to do bumped on a wee mat and just being like, oh, you know, nearly crying, laying down.
Oh, I mean, they're terrified. If you see those big guys, you're thinking, oh no, what if one of them, what if it becomes real? What's going to happen? I'm very small. And going against these humongous guys around the ring. Yeah, that's an interesting class. So DCT traded with Xander, who, if you gave me 100 guesses, I would not have guessed he was there. It was just, that seems like really random. But of course, Robbie Wishart is well, the head trainer's now at Source.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So that's quite the journey that you saw him from training to now he's running the classes.
He had literally just debuted like the week before I started training. Because I remember mentioning that or whatever, and that was a long time ago. I'm trying to remember anyone else that was around that time. Dalen was there, but Dalen was doing the other classes. Like there was three levels of classes. There was beginner, intermediate, and advanced, and Dalen was in the intermediate classes. I didn't meet him for a couple months, but I remember he was around at that time, you know.
And we'll certainly speak about Dalen. He's actually my guest for our next episode. Well, at the moment, haven't recorded it, but he's the planned next episode. So it's just kind of weird how the scheduling turned out that I'm getting one half of amateur wrestling and then next episode is the other half. So it's always good when it works out like that. So you made your debut in 2014. Comedy character, like you say, had the Hawaiian shirts on. I remember seeing photos of that. Was a unicorn there at that point, or that coming out when Manchester Wrestling was together?
Yeah, the unicorn was around that time. Was around after wrestling time. I actually remember my first show. I had ordered a generic gear, but I didn't arrive in time. So I was lucky enough to be wrestling against Mr. Byers, who is one of my favourite people in wrestling. He had brought pleathers that he used to wear, proper indie wrestling. This is like a blue diamond pleathers, and oh, it was quite a look, because still no muscle mass, no nothing. Long hair, and I couldn't grow any facial hair yet, so it was just sort of long hair, horrible looking pleathers, and kick pads that I'd borrowed off someone.
Gotta have the kick pads in if you get the pleathers.
Oh, I was very early 2000s, and it was quite a look.
Yeah, I'm just imagining. Ironically, the first person I'm thinking of is Stephen Richards, because he'd go through a period. I don't know if it was after Chronic, where he would have the blue pleathers with the little white flames at the bottom.
Oh, God. Yeah, those horrible. Oh. Oh, that's, make a comeback.
That's a vision I never thought I'd come back into my brain. But yeah, he still had the short hair at that point as well, so it looked super weird. Yeah, it looked like Rico. But Rico hadn't come round yet.
At least Rico had, nice, tights or whatever, he had the nice look, while Davey had the horrible blue play. Oh, players need to make a comeback in indie wrestling.
There's those shows at the moment. Let's just start from scratch again. Let's just go.
Pleathers,
tribute shows, just all of it. Just all of it. Did you ever, you say you did go to any indie shows before, but did you get dragged into a tribute show at any point, or are you quite lucky?
Oh, no. The thing is, my parents, they've always been supportive, but my dad cannot stand wrestling. He thinks it's the most stupid thing in the world, and I can't really blame him, And I remember we were in a Haven holiday camp, and I was 8 years old or something like that. I remember seeing a poster, and I 100% thought it was real. I'm pointing at it going, Dad, can we go? Can we go? And he's just we're not going.
Yeah, I think my dad's got the same. He took me to one, and it was I've said this in many podcasts. I have so little memory of it, other than there was a fake Mankind, and there was a fan that got attacked by Mankind during it. And as soon as it ended, he turned to me and went, "Well, I'm going to take you into any of them shows again." That was the worst thing I've ever seen. And ironically, the next time I went to see wrestling, it was for my 16th birthday, and it was WWE, and he ended up coming along. So it was one of those, it was so funny going to those shows though, because WWE once, not the tribute once, it was awful. But it was like, mom and dad would take me because I couldn't drive, it was in Aberdeen. And music would go and I'd be like, yes, it's so-and-so. And mom would go, oh, I remember them. And then once we'd both started cheering, my dad would go, oh, right, okay, we're clapping we're clapping this one. I was the only one he went to after that. He was like, no, it's all right, I've done it now. It's at one wrestling show. No, I've seen the wrestling, I've seen all the wrestling, don't need to see anymore. That's it. How long was it between you debuting and then Manchester Wrestling coming about with Dalen?
That was one show. So I had debuted against Mr. Byers, and myself and Dalen were best pals. We met on at a party on Boxing Day 12, and I was I used to drink back then, and I was very, very drunk. I just remember meeting Dalen, and I think he was wearing a ROH something like indie wrestling, and we just started talking about all sorts of wrestling, and it kind of just went from there, where we just became sort of, because we were both I'm not saying really into wrestling, if you know what I mean, learning about weird Japanese wrestlers that no one's ever heard of, talking about that sort of stuff, we were really deep into it, and we just sort of, friendship sort of started from there. And then because me and him were training around the same time, we were trained together all the time, and it was Dalen that actually pushed for us to team together, because his initial idea was Colt Cabana and CM Punk, because at the time he wanted to be a serious wrestler, that's changed a lot since then. He wanted to be this sort of serious wrestling, wanted me to be his sort of, you know, like comedy foil or, you know. And he actually pitched that to Damo at the time, and Damo said, oh, I'm not putting this together. No way. Show later. Amateur Wrestling's born.
Who came up with the name?
I can't actually remember. I remember we had a big printed out like Word document full of potential names, and none of them got used. They were really bad. And I remember, because we actually put together to hide each other's weaknesses, because at the time, Dalen wasn't great at promos, wasn't great with a character, and I couldn't wrestle. I just couldn't wrestle. I was useless, you know? So we're kind of put together to hide each other's weaknesses. So it kind of worked in that way, but I can't remember where the name came from, because I remember we literally had the notes and names, and we walked up, and we seen the call sheet. We're like, oh, Amateur Wrestling. Guess that'll do. Right, let's do this.
That seems to be an interesting way to do it. Yeah. Did you find that, like, working in front of a crowd and actually getting them involved and interacting and being the funny guy, was that, or won't delve humongously deep into it, because, you know, we tried to keep this as possible. We'll speak about you being a mental health survivor or at least living with depression. Did you find making people laugh just being your kind of coping mechanism, and that's why you were able to be so comfortable doing it while wrestling and being the comedy guy?
Yeah, it came out of just being like the first show up, just pure energy, you know, because you're so excited about debuting, and interacting with the crowd kind of just came naturally there. And the thing is, see, when you're wrestling and it's in front of silence and people are doing nothing, like the crowd, just, there is nothing worse. Everything, oh, it's awful. But if you've got that crowd that are behind you, it's almost like not a safety blanket, but it's kind of like it motivates you, and you've got this sort of, you know, drive behind you because you know you're doing a good job. And it kind of came from there, just this, because the thing is, at the end of the day, if I have a match, I always think, was it a good match or a bad match? But the only thing I really care about is these people paid to see me. Did they have a good time? So I'm always making sure that, you know, make sure someone's entertained, make sure they're, you know, laughing or interacting, you know? Like, because at the end of the day, that's all that matters with wrestling, is making sure that fans go home happy.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Giving them a good, and it's the way I've always sort of thought to myself about it is, I've talked to, like Dalen knows this, I've talked to him a lot of times about it, and at the end of the day, I don't really care how the match went. It's if I made one person's life a bit easier that day, because maybe they enjoyed seeing my match and it helped them forget about what's going on in their life, you know? And if I make one person feel like that, that's all I really care about.
Absolutely. I mean, wrestling is, for a lot of us watching this or listening or are even interested in wrestling at all, is your escape. Because, I mean, I know for myself, I'm still quite an anxious person, quite a lonely, not lonely because I've lots of people around me, but I'm quite happy in my own company. Mm-hmm. And wrestling is my escape. So that's what I like to do. And in you saying that, it being just making one person happy, that's enough. I mean, I remember, I think I spoke about it, it's a past interview, probably with Scotty Swift, because we spoke for 4 hours, it was probably brought up then, that going to, my dog died one week, like it was a regular occurrence, right? But he passed away, and I was there, he was put down, and it was very sad. I was crying, everyone was crying, because, you know, dogs are the best.
Yeah.
And then the Saturday, like 2 days later, I think it was, I went to go see WrestleZone. And I had no interest in going, really. I just bought the ticket. I'd had the tickets bought. And I was like, right, okay, I may as well just go to the wrestling then, just because I've got tickets. It'll distract me from watching the dog getting put down. And for that 3 hours, my face, I took a picture of me before the show thinking I was smiling and I looked like I was the most unhappiest person in the world. But it was just, that 3 hours was the best. That's what I needed. I needed that escapism. I needed people just being a bit stupid in a ring for a couple hours. And it's just wrestling itself is just, It's a weird, it's a pantomime where you're all year round, where it just cheers people up. And in your point, it's moments, it's that's why I do reviews on the site, but I prefer to do shows that I've went to see live, because I can feel it and you get the atmosphere. I feel like I write better because of that. I don't want to go, well, so-and-so did a wrist lock and it was a really nice wrist lock and he did this and then, whereas I can just go, a guy kicked him in the head. It was amazing. That was the best part of the show. So it was just, yeah, I'm absolutely with you with that. And I mean, some of your antics has popped up on in GIF form and video form, including your Highland dancing from one of the last source shows with Brandon Adams, Sammy Joe, and Jack, Jetstream Jack himself. So from that point, that bit, that Highland dancing particularly, who came up with that? Whose idea?
That was, I'm trying to think, so we were sort of trying to put the match together and the card got shuffled around. So everyone's sort of packing a bit and we're sort of trying to figure out what we're going to do. And then Sammy just says in the offhand, oh, it's one, or why don't we do some, you know, Highland dancing? And I was like, oh, sounds all right. I had no clue what I'm doing. And I intentionally said to Sammy, don't tell me anything. Let's just go with it, you know? And, she's absolute genius. Like, that was her who came up with that. The whole bit when Brandon Adams spins out. Oh, I spin out and then he hits me with a discus. Oh, it was absolutely brilliant. That's actually one of my proudest matches because, again, like we said, we were on first and it was horrible. The school was freezing. It was a horrible weather outside, but people still came to see us. And we started off that show and made people laugh. You know, when it's that hot. Also, one of my favourite moments from that show was, I think it was about halfway through it. Yeah, it was first half main. Grant McIver comes out.
My first thought came to my head. Yeah, go for it.
So he's trying to get him to boom. And he looks over and he sees the radiator or the heater. And he goes over, turns it off, and just goes, oh, brilliant. And everyone's booing him. And then I think he was wrestling, I think it was Luke Aldridge. I think so. Luke came out, come on. And then went and, oh, and turned it back on. And oh, it was amazing. Because that's the kind of stuff that makes me happy to be a wrestler, just seeing fun like that, you know?
Yeah, that's what I thought. I didn't know if it was from the same show, but I thought it was around about the same time. But I remember seeing the video of Grant just switching off the radiator and getting this mountain of booze from people. It's just like, how no bumps involved. He didn't have to hurt himself. He just literally switched off a radiator and got probably one of the biggest boos of the night just because of that.
We
look at stuff like that, you just think, God, this wrestling stuff's easy, isn't it? You don't have to, it's just as long as you get the reaction. But if it was all that simple, you didn't actually have to take bumps, I think I would actually want to be more involved with it than I am. But at the moment, I'll stick behind the screen and keep it safely there. As if you've listened to any of these podcasts, we do fly around timelines quite a bit. But we'll go back to Reckless Tent. You said you got your gear from, I don't know if you're noticing, I'm using a lot of hands. I watched the Steve Austin podcast with Bailey recently, and he's very much a hand speaker. And yeah. I seem to do that every time I watch more Steve Austin podcasts. Let's play it again. Reckless Intent. You got your gear from Jetstream Jack. You also won your first, and am I right in thinking, only wrestling title so far, Reckless Intent Hardcore Championship?
Up to this moment, yeah.
How did it feel starting off from 2012, training to knowing that you actually got your hands on a title, however fleeting it was, because it was a 24/7 title?
It was something special, you always get a sort of feeling whenever you wrestle a match or even just put your gear on, you know, this sort of, but that, when I just held the title after I won it for a minute and a half, you know, it was amazing. It was this sort of, it was almost like time stopped and I was just like, oh, you know, I done it, you know, if I quit after that match, I would have been happy because I won a belt, you know. Even though it was a 24/7 belt for like 2 minutes, it's on my record, if you mean that I have won a championship in wrestling, you know, which was mental. and getting rolled up for it straight away. That was really fun as well.
Well, especially
my favorite bit actually was just putting my hands on my head afterwards and almost crying, my character in Wrestling 10 early on was close to like a male stripper, that sort of, you know, because I was skinny and I was like, right, I can't be I'm a big, you know, bruiser character, so I was like, hey, I'll just go, you know, completely in the egomaniac direction. So I was like, tantrum Christian time, let's do this. And that was amazing afterwards. I had a lot of fun up in Wrexham Temp when I was there early on.
Yeah, I mean, and now you can say that you won the same title that the likes of Doug Williams has held, because he won it for like an hour when it was right about Discovery Wrestling, and others who every name I'm popping up with got subsequently cancelled in June, but there's a lot of names in there that have held that belt, that I think I have a record of it on, well, it's not on the website at the moment.
Sugar Duncan, I think he won.
Yeah, so some of the biggest names in Scottish and independent wrestling have held that title, and you're in that list.
Right at the top of the list. If you're looking at shortest reign, then you're, you know, wrestling it, so it was, you know, shortest to longest, right at the bottom, yeah.
Still on the list. That's the most important thing. So how did you go from the manliest man in wrestling, manager wrestling, to the street rat?
The thing is, now I've got I've picked up this sort of thing of I'm always thinking about what to sort of do next. Whether it be like a tiny change to my character, whether it be like even something as simple as new music, a new look, or a new, like, say, style of wrestling. So I'm always thinking about what to do next. Because then you look at guys like, say, Matt Hardy or Chris Jericho, who are geniuses with reinventing themselves. And it's for my first 2 years in wrestling, I was doing the manliest man gimmick. And I was dressing the same way, coming to the same music, wrestling basically almost the same way. And I started feeling a bit down on it, because I was having the same stuff. I wasn't pushing myself forward, you know. So myself and Dalen actually taking a year out from teaming together. Like, the idea was, because we had teamed too much, we didn't want to become a crutch on each other. So it was like, we'd still manage each other occasionally, but we'd focus more on singles stuff, like matches. And the idea was he could develop on his like character and parts like that, and I could develop on my wrestling. And my idea was, what would Manlon do now, because he's now been ripped apart? And my first idea was, he's got nothing, he's homeless, you know. So I could kind of get closer to the image that I wanted to be as a wrestler, you know. So I thought I'd go with a sort of more homeless, because then in theory I could be a bit more aggressive and I could sort of change the way I wrestle to go with that character. And I was still doing quite a lot of comedy stuff with occasional bits of wrestling. And then I remember it was a match with Sean Walker, when the King of the Streets was the perfect time to just go full serious for that one bit. So then that means, so when I got the new nickname, that was different look, different sort of attitude, you know. So that was when I'd say I almost completed my transformation from a comedy guy to an actual wrestler, if you get what I mean.
Hmm.
Like a wrestler who can just do comedy. So it was kind of like, just had to change with the times, and that's kind of how it went.
Yeah. I mean, the match at the King of Streets, of course, Sean Walker, was this ginger white guy, very creative, but he thought he was black. That was the character. So when he came about with that character initially, was there a part of you just going, "Hold up, you're doing a street gimmick, I'm doing a street gimmick," or was it just a case of whoever was in charge just went, "Right, you guys are doing street gimmicks, we're going to put this together," or was there a bit of creative involvement from the two of you?
It was so that we had three matches in total on shows. So actually, no, that's a lie. We had four. So we had four, but this is before he was, you know, he was doing that gimmick. He went by the Hero Killer at the start. So we done that. He done that gimmick at first, and then in our second match, he had a really good. Like, this was just a showcase, and it was just a case of me and him were there, you know. So we had a really good match, and we were sitting afterwards going, maybe we could actually, you know, do something here. And because the match was that good, the next, I think it wasn't next show, it was a couple of shows afterwards, we were put together again. And again, we had a really good match. And it's only after that, me and Sean sat down and went, here, we could actually do something here. And he mentioned the king, like the idea of the King of the Streets match. And I was just like, yep, that sounds great. Because I've got a love for, like I said, my love for like violent or hardcore wrestling or, you know, more stuff like that. And he pitched it. And next thing I know, we're coming in with weapons and all that to use and try to come up with ideas. And yeah, honestly, at the end of the day, that's my favourite match I've ever done. Like, that's gonna be, at the end of the day, that's gonna be the one I'm gonna remember and go, aye, there we go. You know, that's the one I'm proudest of. Because I remember, my mom and dad my dad doesn't care, watch wrestling or doesn't want, but I got him to cringe over something. Because there was a moment in the match where we're on the outside and we set up two chairs like that. And I hit like a spinning suplex from the apron onto the floor through the chairs. And I literally remember waking up and looking up and seeing my dad just going like, oh, because it looked horrible. I was like, here we go, I've done it. And the thing is, that wasn't the sore thing. It was getting hit with a trolley that hurt the most. Like, I got hit, he ran a trolley into me. And I felt my skeleton move, but my body stay still. That was grim.
Oh, right, yeah. Your bones rattling. Instead. Oh man. But I mean, this might not be the most memorable match you've ever had, though, because according to my research, you have an elimination over Papa Shango in SWA Battle Zone. Some others eliminated Papa Shango from the Battle Zone. How, I mean, as a fan of growing up of these wacky characters and things like that, how weird was that?
Billy, come here. Billy, that was absolutely amazing. Like, because I one thing I always remember is we were setting the ring up, and you know, big Papa Shango, best pals with Godfather, of course. So we're setting the ring up, and I remember the Godfather came up and he was a bit hungover from the night before and says, oh, I've got to stretch off to, you know, get rid of this. And he just started doing the whole train as he's going down the arena, just doing the wee whole train dance, and that's him stretching off. And I was just like, this is amazing, I've made it, that's it, wrestling will never be any better than this. So, and I remember he came over and talked to me, and he talked to everyone, saying hi to them. And we were sitting in the back, and the call sheet then got up to about half time about what was happening in the battle zone. And then it just pops up, and I see like there's 10 people, then Papa Shango, and then me. And I'm just like I've got this chance. And I remember I went up to him and says, because he said, you know, his idea was straight away, he's like, I don't want to spend as little time as I do, because he has to get changed. He has to go tell his friend, the Godfather, to go, you know, and get ready. So I said to him, like, I've got an idea. Could we do this little thing? Like, I was literally coming, you know, bump and bar, bump, fuzzy. And then I turn around and I'll do the back, like the horror movie. So I sort of back up to him, and he's right behind me. Turn around, the big screen myself. And then, you know, we all sort of chuck him out, or I chuck him out, and he was just like, oh yeah, brother, that's a great idea. And I was like, oh, yes. And it was just the idea of, like, because I was sitting backstage afterwards, you know, just going like, Hogan never got a pinfall victory over Papa Shango. Warrior didn't either.
So I've been lucky enough to meet a few wrestlers from my childhood, like Billy Gunn and all that kind of stuff, and it's still crazy to think that you meet these people, but to actually have a spot with And now just all I can see is just like him hunched over, just doing the whole train down a wee hall now, and that's all amazing. I can see. I was in your head just going choo 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 choo.
I just had his music playing in the background, just because I think I was talking to like Matt Daly or something at the time. Like, I was just in the hall, and we overheard him down there, and he looked up, and he's just coming towards us, going like, "Oh, it was amazing." Oh,
best. So in your travels in wrestling, you've obviously wrestled in Source, SWA, along with Pride, and Caithness Pro Wrestling. So Caithness, that's a bit out of the way. So what's it like traveling? Well, past where I am, I'm in the northeast. So up into would be Thurso, I'm guessing Wicker Thurso.
Yeah, and I'm not. Yeah. It was a great experience. Like, so we went up, and the promoter was looking at was, you know, gracious enough to put us up for the night. So it was literally like this big wrestler sleepover. And remember, like, I love long journeys. Like, I'm not a driver, so I'm not, you know, I can hardly say how horrible a drive was like that. But I loved it because I was just sitting in the back, and it was a beautiful journey up. Like, once you Inverness, because it's motorways until then, and then it's big, beautiful country roads, and you know, big old, you know, like country houses, and then wee villages, and but, like, hills and all that. It's absolutely beautiful. And I was just sitting, and most of the time I'd be driving up, it'd be me in Dunbar, you know, Robbie Wishart, Lucha DS, and Dalen, and we would just sit and talk for ages about just. We'd talk about wrestling for the first half hour, and then we get bored of wrestling and talk about other stuff and all that, and then just enjoying the journey. It was amazing, you know.
Yeah, and it's definitely in front of a different crowd as well, being so far away.
Oh yeah, and it was amazing getting to wrestle there because it was just so different from, you know, before. Because I think I was in a battle royal at first, and I don't know what I did, but people liked me. And my second match was against the Machine, and that was absolutely amazing as well. And suddenly, just kids liked me, and they were cheering for me, and they were like, "I could do anything." They'd be reacting, you know. And I remember on the third show, it was me and Matt Daly, and we were out first, and we had like really good match. And I remember the crowd was it was so much fun. And Matt Daly's absolutely brilliant as well. It's mostly him doing stuff and me just standing there going, "Punch, punch," you know. But Matt Daly doesn't get enough credit. He's amazing.
Caithness, I mean, especially when I watch some of their shows when they're on YouTube, yeah, the crowd's just rabid for it. I think it's mainly because at that point, I think they only did like 4 or 5 shows a year. Mm-hmm. And other than that, maybe W3L would pop up once. During that time, so 6 shows a year, you got to enjoy the wrestling while you can get it.
Yeah. And when I was up there, it was mostly like small villages and stuff like that. So it was absolutely lovely, you know, being there. But I was like, I don't imagine there's much. So they're probably rabid for stuff, because I remember we're talking to some of the guys that wrestled up there, and they were saying how they had to go to, I can't remember what show it was that was up there, but they had to go to like Inverness, which is like a 3-hour drive away. And I found that insane, because, you know, I lived in Glasgow all my life, and now I'm in Kirkintilloch. I'm like 20 minutes away from the, you know, city centre. It's the idea of driving 3 hours for a gig, I'm just, you know.
Yeah, I mean, for myself, Elgin, so we get W3L once a year. That's usually around about my birthday, which is great, because usually some sort of shenanigans happen with Bulgarian Baker. And then if I want to go to shows any time of the year, it's 1.5 hours to Aberdeen, which doesn't sound long, but Aberdeen is just a pain in the arse to drive in. If I can avoid it, I usually get my wife to drive it, go, "Oh, we'll go to Pizza Hut."
And that's 1.5 hours there, 1.5 hours back, you know?
Yeah, and in Inverness, it's about 45 an hour, depending on traffic as well. So it's bang in the middle of plenty of wrestling, but it's just like you say, it's 3 hours travel for a show. And then if you're going, you'd be as well get food. So it's a whole day event. If you're going to the wrestling, yeah. It's a whole day thing. Whereas Glasgow, it could be just, oh, I need to get the train or I need to get a bus over to 20 minutes away. There we go. There's the show. And then plenty of places round about to eat afterwards. It is a little bit different. It's a bit weird. That's why I kind of, there's many reasons why I set up OSWTV and then SWN, because I want to know about everything that's happening, but I can't go to it because I'm so far away from everything as well. But speaking of doing the podcast, things like that, you're starting your own one. You probably would have started it by the time this episode goes out in February, called Word on the Street. The first guest being with Scott McManus. What was your inspiration behind starting your own podcast series?
It kind of just came out of what I sort of my own sort of things I like listening to or like or enjoy watching. Like I watch a lot of YouTube about like, and I think I love is video games and game collectors, and just hearing their sort of passion for it, I was like, I realised it doesn't matter if it's something I'm not really interested in, I'll sit and listen to someone if they're passionate about it. And it's, I just wanted to, and that was my idea, was just have people on to talk, like, not necessarily wrestling, it just happens to be a lot of my social circle is wrestling, you know? But my idea was to, like, talk to, like, Scott McManus, was to talk about, maybe to start off with the wrestling and how that's how we met, and just go from there, because you wanted, like, I think that's one thing we're going to talk about. We both work in care, and to kind of, you know, talk about that and our inspirations behind that, and then just talk about other stuff in our life. And he's also a big, you know, he's got a lot of animals. Talk about, you know, stuff like that. And that was just my original idea. And then I've got pals that work in TV. I've got, you know, my fiance's an artist, and just get as many different life experiences on that, you know, we can get. Because I'm a nerdy, born white guy. There's only so much I can experience, you know. So just hear about, you know, a bunch of other people's, that'll be a bit more interesting. And also, why not just give it a try? Same idea as wrestling.
Absolutely. I mean, I started this. This was just kind of like, there's lockdown. I need to do something because I can't write about it anymore. So try a podcast. Podcasting is not that difficult. I think anyone with internet connection and a microphone can really do podcasting. Whether they do it well is a total other matter at all. But I've always said any idiot can do a podcast, because I could do one as well. So it's also a nice way, because of all this lockdown things happening, it's a nice way to actually interact with people. So that's also the plus point. So I think outside of my wife and my dog, this is the only way I speak to other people that I like. I'm in a job that involves customer services, which, you know, you don't really want to speak to them if you want to avoid it. So this is the only nice way to speak about anything. And we're kind of the same. I kind of want to speak about wrestling because that's the thing I know more about, but we end up speaking about dinosaurs, which we will get to. We end up speaking about anything in between, just because wrestlers just don't, their whole life isn't wrestling.
What I've realized when I get close to something, like, I've got quite a lot of really close friends in wrestling, but I've noticed the ones I get really close with are the ones that I connect with on other things, like movies or, you know, any sort of other cultural stuff, because we talk about wrestling all the time. You get bored of it eventually, you know, because myself and Dalen would just talk about like nerdy, like me and him differ a lot on movies and stuff like that, and our sort of taste. Like, I'm an absolute snob, I'll admit that. But, you know, like, love of comic books and movies and stuff like that went from there. And I get like my fuzzy, it's close to, like, you know, stuff like working in care. And then again, because most wrestlers are nerds, there's usually something we can, you know, talk to about that, you know.
Oh yeah, I mean, if you get into wrestling, there's some sort of hero complex isn't the word, but like superhero complex, where you want to be the big hero conquering, or the big villain, or something like that. There's always, even if you don't say you like comic books or don't think you like comic books, that superhero thing must be in the back of your head going, well, I need the crowd to cheer me because I am the all conquering, I am the hero, and or something like that. Favorite, what would be your say top five favorite comic book heroes or villains or characters?
Well, my favourite team ever is a group called the Young Avengers, which Marvel done an initial 5-issue run, and it's my favorite comic book ever. It's just like there was a time when the Avengers weren't about in the comics, and it was these people who are kind of connected to the Avengers, as like one of them's Ant-Man's daughter, one of them is ends up being Scarlet Witch's son. Oh no, two of them actually. Two of them end up being like Witch and Vision's son, and it's they kind of have to fill the void in that time, and it's absolutely amazing. It's my favorite comic book ever. And more people need to read Young Avengers. Marvel needs to do something with them because they're not doing anything with them. I went through a big thing of reading the Hulk now. Like there was a run called The Immortal Hulk, which was absolutely amazing. And then there's obvious ones like Batman, Wolverine, you know. I've not read as many comic books as I have, as I used to. Just due to because it used to be part of my thing is I'd, be working or I'd be wrestling. And then I'd go to from Planet on the Way Back or something like that, So obviously without that, I've not had as much, reading it as much recently. I need to get back into it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more into the films. I'll readily admit that. I love my superheroes, I like my comics and comic characters, but most of mine comes from the film franchises. I mean, I can probably count on one hand how many comics I've actually read in my life, but my favourite one being Watchmen. It's one that I actually just, I've read several, so many times, and then I watched the film and I thought, this is what I wanted. I'm quite happy I didn't have the tale of Black Freighter in there because it was a bit of a drag in the middle of it. But the ending was changed, of course, because it didn't have the giant squid and all that kind of stuff.
Have you seen the new TV series?
I started watching it. I think I need to give it another go because it didn't really grip me right away.
It starts off slow, but it's really good. It's worth it.
But I know it has its timeline is from the squid attack.
Comic, yeah.
Yeah, it's from the squid.
My mother-in-law's watching it and they have to explain to her, no, the giant squid's in it. It's from the comic. Not this isn't a sequel to the show, the movie. And she's just like,
I know. As soon as I started, I thought, will it be? And then they had the rain and I was like, okay. That's the squid. It's okay, cool. I'm with it. But yeah, I started and then I just stopped. But I'll get there. I'll get back to it eventually. Right. We've got loads of questions in, so I'm going to try and get through them. But before we do that, what's your favourite dinosaur?
I think every kid around my age loved it. We'd go to Jurassic Park and stuff. As a kid, it was Velociraptor, but I was also terrified of them. And then it was Ankylosaurus, the ones with the big ball tails, push up things. Purely because I had a game called Jurassic Park Warpath, and I always played with one of them in it.
So Velociraptor is a very popular choice. Ankylosaurus is coming up quite a lot nowadays. I don't know if I'm just picking people that were around for Jurassic Park originally that I've seen the Ankylosaurus or what have you, but it seems to be popular. I thought it was a made up one the first person said it, and then I know of it. I just couldn't remember the name of it at the time. Anyway, we'll go to the questions. Taylor Veit, he's got quite a few, so we'll get through that. He's asked, am I still top of your wrestlers I'd like to kiss list, or is Ibushi finally claimed top spot? And who are the other most kissable wrestlers?
Oh, it's close. I mean, and we'll have to see because Kota Ibushi, I don't know how he is aged so well because he's nearly 40 and he looks like 17. It also helps he's one of the best wrestlers in the world and most mental as well from what I've seen. Have you seen that video of him at, I think it was XWA down in England, and he's got a lit firework in his hand. It's going off, and he does a moonsault as it's going off. Oh, it's the best.
Yeah, I've seen that, and I've also seen him being used as a weapon during a Sami Zayn match. I'll be honest, Japanese wrestling, that's just not my thing. I haven't watched enough of it, but from what I've seen of Kota Ibushi, every time I see a gif of his, I'm just like, how? How are you still? How are you so scar free and alive?
When you see the falls, it
so horrific. So yeah, who else? We've got Taylor Veit, we've got Kota Ibushi. Who else is the most kissable wrestlers?
I'm trying to think. Rusev, definitely. My big beautiful boy. And I think ADM, I think he's got a gruff exterior, but I think he's a kind, compassionate man underneath that.
I'm sure his best friend, Emily Hayden, would agree as well. That he's going to hate me for saying that. And so I'm not even sorry about it.
I'll protect you. It's okay.
So that gave us four. Let's round off with the nice clean five. Who'd be your fifth most kissable?
Try to think. Can't think of it. I've literally forgotten every single. I'll say Crush, because, you know.
Of course.
He's what got me into wrestling, so I think I should give him a wee peck in the cheek just to thank him for that.
Are we sticking with Chronic Crush? Or, I mean, Kona Crush is a bit cute. Or Demolition with the old leather.
I think maybe Kona Crush is more the one you'd want to bring up to your parents to let them meet. Because I think you'd be a bit wary if you brought back, like, Prison Crush or, like,
Demolition Chronic Crush would be a bit weird one to bring back as well, to be honest.
Yeah, so I think maybe we could start off with Crush from the Hawaiian era and then sort of edge our way into the other ones, you know?
There's always a Shaka Bra and Making Kids Cry Bra and all that kind of stuff. There you go, shout out to OSW Review for that.
My boys.
And Japanese Traitor Crush. Oh, there's so many crushes you could choose from.
What
a guy. Rest in peace. We'll move on from that. He's also asked, the other guy's also asked, we were speaking about the tribute shows earlier. He asked, who would you want to be on a WWF tribute show and who would you actually end up being?
So I think, like, me and Taylor have a love for these. Like, we'll sit back, you know, we'll sit as training's going on and go, here, can you imagine? So that's where the joke, so there's a joke that we always refer to Fuzzy as Taz, and say how he'd get over is if he put on a singlet and just sort of suplex people. So we'll sit to each other and just go, oh, there's Fuzzy hit a Taz Plex. Oh, he's hit the ones that literally everyone does is a Taz something. Oh, it's amazing. Pops us every time. But so I'd want to be someone like long hair, let me think. Okay, Crush. I'm gonna go with Crush. Even though I'm the shortest tall guy, I'd love to be what era Crush could I do? Probably Prison Crush, just get the Sharpie and, you know, just paint tattoo on like he did.
But I was thinking Japanese Traitor Crush, you know, with the kicks. Just lots of kicks and
there we go. Oh, I wanna be that era Crush.
Mullet as well. It's a mullet. It's a mullet.
Just need to go to the hairdressers that is not far from Swords and just get a big perm just as I come in. Like I said, I'd love to do that, but now that lockdown's hit me and I've been lazy, I'm probably going to end up being a Mick Foley or something like that. No offence to Mick Foley. I'll absolutely love Mick Foley, but, you know, long hair, beard, and...
So would you be just a Cactus Jack, or would you go for a Mankind, just get a shirt and tie and just a mask?
Oh, TNA Mick Foley, get the big shirt on.
Former TNA champion. Mick Foley. That popped up on my YouTube yesterday. What weird timing for that to pop up. I loved Mick Foley's TNA run. It was so awfully brilliant.
I mean, like, genuinely, I think the match he had with his last match against Ric Flair, I genuinely think that was a good one. Because hand on heart, I love Ric Flair in his old age, just being a deathmatch wrestler. It's great.
He had a match in WWE ECW. Where he ended up just, I don't know what happened, but of course he bled because Ric Flair. And ended up getting choke slammed on drawn pins.
It was like him and Big Show, and I think he wrestled Edge in a TLC match, a couple of weeks before. And then next thing you know, you think maybe because he's a bit older at that time, you think you'd give him a couple of weeks off to recover. No, match with a Big Show. Hang on to the thumbtacks. I'm just like, Mick, what are you doing?
I think a couple of weeks later, he did Money in the Bank at WrestleMania. Did the old backdrop off the top of the ladder.
He did. And then, oh my God, and then by SummerSlam, he had that match with Mick Foley. I quit match. Those thumbtacks again.
2006, what a year for Ric Flair.
Ric Flair's the best, man. He just given up and went, oh, got to do some death matches or hardcore wrestling. The best. Well, that was one thing I wanted to say. Have you heard the story about Frankie Sloan on a tribute show?
I've heard his name pop up with tribute shows before, but no, just play it on me.
So, he was in the opener as X-Pac because he had a beard and long hair. Went backstage, shaved, came to the main event as Matt Hardy, which is probably what I'm going to have to do as well.
So you want to be Crush, but you'll end up being Mankind or Matt Hardy.
Whoever's got long hair, you know, just walk in, just throw something at me. You know? You're the stinky DX top, your X-Pac.
Well, it's supposed to the poster that keeps going around, which is like instead of X-Pac, he's called Degenerate X.
I think it's the best. Oh, I love it. Like Legion of Doom. Oh, Legend of Doom, I think it is.
Legend of Doom, yeah. Legend of Doom's in there.
Who else was that? There's RIP, which was Undertaker.
The Rocks one. It was something. Was it Maivia something? Or it's going to annoy me, but it was awful.
I love all of them. Like, I wish I wrestled around that time, because it would have been dreadful, but it would have been amazing as well. Literally just coming out, hitting a couple of poses, and doing a really crappy version of someone's finisher. And hearing some, you know, commentary going, and here we have X-Pac! And I'm just like, ah! It'd be the best.
I just want to know where these guys are. Like, they kind of just disappeared off the face of the planet. Must be somewhere. They must be, like, still alive, I'm guessing. But
I remember because Dalen and Dunbar wrestled for somewhere called, I think it was TPW, they've done Helensburgh, and because Dalen lived in Helensburgh, they booked him for that. And I remember I was down in Blackpool one time, and TPW had a poster up, and it was, I can't remember the guy's name, but he literally had a big Road Warrior look, and I'm just like, is that a tribute show? It wasn't. I was ready. I didn't go see it, but I was just very tempted to.
I found the poster. Oh, I guess this guy's name with the Rock. Oh, where is it? Rock Steadfast is the Rock.
Oh, yes, man.
Brett Rico is DX. Brad Kirk.
Is Satan's Daughter, I think it is, which is China. Which I don't really get that one.
Well, this one we've got Harley Davidson as the Undertaker. Harvey Davidson. Don't want to be
there
sued.
We go.
And Brad Kirk is Kane, which that looks awful.
It's just some guy in a Halloween costume. Oh,
it's. I think it's worse than that. It's just so bad. But
we missed out, Billy. We missed out so much.
I know. I just wish I remembered more of the one I went to see. Because every so often it pops into my head and go, right, I'm going to Google. I want to find this show.
I done a deep dive looking on, like, you know, old places like UKFF or whatever. Just trying to find stories about tribute shows, and there was one where a guy was called the Dudley Boy, and it's just a guy looks basically like me with short hair, wearing a camo top and a camo bottoms, doing a leg drop off a really rickety cage, and I'm just, mate, I missed out so badly.
I think this is the key to getting wrestling back once the shows begin, just so everyone can kind of take it easy, ease themselves in. Everyone should have an alternative WWF tribute character. I mean, ADM could be Undertaker, because, you know, he's tall, long hair, sorted, easy as that. But, you know, that's the key to get us back into it. Taylor's still got questions. He's also asked, your favourite moment in wrestling? I'm assuming it's elimination, Pap Shango.
Honestly, like, I could say any sort of big moment in wrestling that stands out to me, but my favourite time ever in wrestling is literally when we've finished a show, like usually a showcase show, we're knackered and we just go out for some tea afterwards, sitting in the worst bins, just, you know, chilling with the guys, talking to them, or chilling with everyone. That's my favourite point in wrestling. Just, or when you're sitting after a match and you're sweating, just waiting your body to stop sweating so you can get changed and watching the rest of the card. They're my favourite times, I think.
And he's also asked, how's your dog?
She is alright. She is sleeping there, and as you've heard, she's barking at things because she thinks she's a wee guard dog, and she thinks she's a Rottweiler, even though she's a tiny spaniel.
My dog's a very quiet dog, but she barks at the oddest of things. Just like what are you going to do? You're a beagle-sized Labrador. You're really not going to do much if anything comes your way. So Jason Hyde is asked, ask him if he would like to fight. No beef, he just likes fighting. So would you fight Jason Hyde?
No, but, there's one regret I have in wrestling is not being as sociable as, you know, as I should be, because I usually like my bubble and talk to people I knew. And it's only in the last couple of years I've actually started meeting a lot of people outside the source. Like I met, Shea Monet, or, you know, artist formerly known as Jesse Santana. I met Jetstream Jack right at the start of training, because he added me on Facebook and we just started talking from there. But apart from like a couple of hours, I didn't really get close to a lot of people outside the source. Well, I didn't meet them, you know. And it's only now I'm realizing, like, oh, you know, there's always people that I've never met before that I'd eventually like to, you know, even just meet, get to know, or whatever. Like, I'd love to wrestle, like I said, Jason Hyde. I've seen a lot of really good stuff for him. Guys like Stone Malone as well, I'd love to wrestle. Ewan O'Raw, I'd love to wrestle. There's tons of people that I've not been lucky enough to meet. But hopefully that will change once wrestling starts up again.
Absolutely. And there's a lot of places now. I think when things obviously start up.
And I'd like to barter him as well.
Of course. there'll be, I think, a lot of places. Glasgow will be very lucky in this, because I think a lot of places will be trying to concentrate and having a core roster. Maybe the ones they don't have to travel in as far, just for logistic reasons or for not spreading things, kind of thing. If it's still on the fence of what's happening with COVID and what have you, so I think there'll be a lot of opportunities. Definitely Glasgow Central Belt for new matches. To keep things fresh as well. So you never know, you could be battering Jason Hyde before you know it. We've got ADM, who's asked, how are you going to follow an ADM shoot fest? Which highlights did include, we spoke about that Dean Ford photo, which finally got that story about it. He did speak about shoot interviews. Have you got any particular favourite shoot interviews from your time watching?
I think there's... Like, obviously, you know, you've got your highlights like Jim Cornette and stuff like that, but that's what me and ADM, you know, sort of love to talk about is shoot interviews. And there's one, I think it's called, it's developmental something, and it's Kurt Hawkins, Luke Gallows, Tangaloa, and I can't remember the other guy's name. Oh, and there's another guy there, and it's hilarious. Me and ADM just sort of bond over quoting Luke Gallows in that.
Were you a big fan of the Talking Shop Mania, which I have not seen, but
Heard it was awful. It was amazing. Like, it was that level of it's meant to be bad. I've also got a love for really bad wrestling, or like hilarious wrestling, you know? Like, that's something I could see one slot down to cams if, you know, we're just sitting chilling, just watching that with some of the wrestling guys and howling. Me and ADM always do before matches. We'll sit and he'll open up like a YouTube compilation of All Japan finishers. You know, all these ones where it's just people getting dropped on the head or getting kicked in the face and just howl at it. Oh, it's the best. It's hilarious. And then we'll go, and we're going to do that. We'll do that. Comedy match. Bang. Drop again. Oh, it's amazing.
I think we got your love of terrible things. We were speaking earlier about your regret of missing tribute shows, of never getting to do or take part in them. He's also asked, do you feel guilty about the time you told him to get colour and he ended up in hospital?
We were on a bridge. It was in Bridgeton. We were doing a show, and I think he was in a handicap match. It was him, and I think it was him and Zero versus Craig Forsyth. And he jokingly said, oh, I'm not going to do it in the match. I said to him, oh, remember, get colour though, like lock up. And then he comes in from his match and he accidentally broke it. Something's happened, he broke his nose, and he comes in and his face is covered in blood. And he's just sitting down. I'm going, oh crap, you know, helping him take off his boots. And the first thing he goes is, I blame Manlon. I jokingly said to him to get colour. And then from now on, I always make a joke to him, like, I'm doing that, just, you know, eat a wee.
um, Yeah, he did. He asked me specifically after I spoke to him to ask that question. He wrote it down anyway, so thank God, because I would never remembered it, but totally worth it. We've got Jack, Jetstream Jack, he's here as well. We've already spoken about him at length. But speaking to him when things first started, but he's asked, if you and him tagged, what would your tag name be, and who would you face?
We'd have to go with the, you know, biggest stars of the SWN. Was it Survivor Series? Was that the one with the three groups?
Clan Warfare, I think it might have
been. Clan Warfare, that was it. We'd have to go with the star team that, obviously, you know, we don't talk about the results, but, you know, the breakout stars of that, the Hobo Banders.
Of course. We'd
have to go with that. And as you can see with my love of, you know, we'll have to get the time machine going, and we're going back to WCW Worldwide. We're getting the Hobo Banders versus Chronic. And there we go.
Are you going to include the when we get hit by the chair shots, when it has the Batman blam and
of course blam?
has to be. That's I don't remember a lot from Worldwide. I remember Chronic and all that kind of stuff, but I always remember the Batman.
I remember
kablam.
Oh, I remember it was like one thing that sticks in my mind specifically from Worldwide is we're flicking through the channel, and this must have been late 2000 or early 2001, and seeing Mike Awesome and Lance Storm making an entrance and just being like. Because Mike Awesome, huge, and just just being so surprised, because this wasn't WWE, I didn't know who they were, and I was just like, wow, you know? And then just seeing Mike Awesome bomb someone, because I'd never seen anything like that before, and just, you know?
Yeah.
And now Mike Awesome's one of my favourite wrestlers.
His match with Masato Tanaka at One Night Stand is still probably in my top 10, I would think, somewhere. It's not my kind of wrestling, but it's just watching it with the commentary and the crowd and just everyone eating everything up. I'm just like...
Oh, that finish when he power bombs him out the ring and then does a suicide dive on top of him.
When the camera missed it. The camera missed it. They just...
All you see is his head going bleh on top of him. Oh, it's amazing. That's what wrestling's meant to be.
He didn't get the memo that WWE liked things to breathe for a couple of seconds, and he was just like, nah, I'm going...
Dives on top of him.
I've been told to wrap up, I'm going for it. Oh, man. But no, like I said, not my kind of match, but it's just mental. Dylan Hendry, he's asked, why do you keep telling him to get gout?
That was, if I remember, it was on a promo class, I think. It was something like that. We're doing promos on each other. And I was getting bored of doing the same usual, I'm going to wrestle you and I'm going to win and I respect you as a wrestler. So I just went, Dalen, hope you get gout. And it made him laugh and he was just like, what? And I just kept saying it now because it made him laugh, you know. And it's... Because people in Source, especially when, you know, we've done pro classes, they're amazing because we're so diverse with our characters and all that, which I'm very, you know, something that's really cool, especially in wrestling now, even, you know, like, one guy I always enjoy seeing promos of is Yuno Raw. Makes me laugh every single time, you know. It just came out of promo class as a one-off thing, and now it just became every time I've got any sort of promo, even on Twitter or something like that, if I'm like, right, I want to say something to Dalen, hope you get gout, you know.
The question made me laugh more because I get gout, so I was just like, that's the exact same. I was looking at it going, why would you tell someone that? I just have to not eat anything that's pickled, but you know, I'm only human. Pickled eggs, I'm eaten.
I think my mum gets it a lot, so I think that's where the idea probably came from. I just went, gout?
It's one of those things where you can wish it on someone because sometimes they'll just mean that your joints are a little bit sore and other times you can't walk. It's just a very particular, very clever, particular, horrible thing to get. But it's like, oh, we'll only get a little bit of gout. Just get gout. Anyway, Colton Davis asked, in return for the question you asked him, why are you not tall? We already established you're not as tall as Cage Match makes you out to be.
Because all my family are really short. My dad's 5'6" and my mum's like 5'4" roundabout, and my sister's tiny as well. So I don't know what happened to me. I think I'm probably the milkman. There's probably, even in that out, there's probably like a 6'5", 6'6" milkman somewhere. And it's just half, you know, Hobbit jeans and half, you know, giant jeans. I remember thinking to myself, oh, I'm really tall. I'm basically Kevin Nash because all my pals as well were short. I went to wrestling and I'm like, hey, how's it going? Because they're all really... But I'm like just over that threshold where I'm like considered tall. But you put me next to like ADM and Colton Davis and I'm just, yeah. I'm like Hornswoggle next to them. But then you put me in the ring with like Scott McManus and I'm just, you know, Kevin Nash, you know.
I think he could be a choice for who you'd end up being a tribute show. Diesel.
But I'd love to be it, but again, it'd be like, I'd be fine if I'm in there with like Mark Wilson or Austin Brooks now, you know. If I was in with him, great, Diesel impression would be the best. But then with anyone else, no, I can't do that. The ex-Packer Matt Hardy, there we go.
He's also asked your goals for 2021.
I put up a big thing last year, like this is what I want to do in wrestling, but right now my goals are just hopefully get back to training. Like, I'm well aware that I'm probably not going to get to wrestle this year, but I'm absolutely fine with it. I'd rather that we wait until, you know, because of the kind of work I do, you know, I'd rather it kind of waits till it's a bit un-COVID-y, you know?
Yeah, that sounds fair.
But my main goal is to be able to actually bump this year so I don't get extremely out of... Because I'm afraid when I actually go back and do that first bump, I'll just go, no, I don't like wrestling anymore. I'm done. That's it.
That's what I'm like expecting. That's what I'm expecting. It's like, shows can come back now. I've retired. I'm now retired because I've just taken that one bump and just went, nah, I'm all right.
Just wait to see me. I'll just refuse to bump the next thing. All my matches will just be someone, I'll be standing in the middle and people running around me. And the finish will be like, shoulder block, one, two, three, there we go. Because I'm like, I'm no bumping. I'm no doing anything.
And he's also asked, are your dream opponents?
So I think I said this in another podcast. It was like, see if I had, like again, give me the time machine. I'd love to be NWA era Ric Flair, like, when he was the NWA champion going around wrestling all the big stars in our territories. Every night he'd do a 60-minute match, and he'd make our guy look amazing. And, you know, he'd always come on top with a time limit draw or, you know, the screwy finish or whatever. But that's what I'd love, because isn't it weird when if people would say like Hogan or John Cena, because you'd probably get squashed by them, you know? It would give you some amount if he was around that era. I just wouldn't survive the night at the partying afterwards. I might literally die just hearing about the stuff they did. Right, NWE or Ric Flair. There we go. 60-minute draw. Make it look amazing.
And just from the current crop of wrestlers that are around, who would be up there, would just be Nick Gage, deathmatch.
Oh, I'd love Nick, yeah. If I don't be goals, I will have a deathmatch before I, you know, eventually gee up wrestling. But Nick Gage will be up there. I'd love to wrestle. I'd be lucky enough to wrestle any sort of big name, but Nick Gage was definitely, like, if I had a list, it would be at the very top.
And before we round out and do that, because I think we're creeping past an hour and a half up to 2 hours here, so we'll end with a 10 count and then we'll do your social media and Twitch channel and all that kind of thing. I think I've ticked off everything on my general list here. So 10 count is just a read out a name, give me your first thoughts, first impressions, phrase, word, whatever. I've stolen a lot of them. I just scrolled through your Twitter and picked names as I went along, just from your Twitter feed. Anyway, so number one, Mankind.
Creepy, sympathetic, really good character.
Two, Chainsaw Charlie. You could put Terry Funk for this, better.
Yeah, I was going to say strange, but it was his idea to be Chainsaw Charlie from what I can gather. But a good wee run.
Three, The Godfather.
Oh, stretching off, doing Motherwell Civic Centre Hall, and the best.
Four, Undertaker.
If you asked me this last year, I would have said the best. But now that we've, you know, seen that documentary and seen what kind of stuff he supports, whoa, you know.
Yeah, a little bit weird. Five, Cactus Jack.
One of my favourites, Royal Rumble 2000 is one of my favourite matches ever.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll probably end up watching that because we're in Rumble season in the recording timeline.
Well, yeah, Rumble 2000 is one of the best shows ever. From start to finish, it's the best.
It was the first one I recorded off Channel 4. It was amazing. Anyway, right, I'm getting off the count here. 6, Scott McManus.
Scott McManus. Daz.
7, Ken Shamrock. I don't know why I put that one in there, but...
Big scary guy screams at everything, watches match with Vader, where Vader tells him to ease up, and he doesn't, and then Vader clocks him. Amazing. It's the best.
8, Stevie Richards.
Big inspiration, drastically underrated.
9, Nick Gage.
The best. God, King, best ever.
At 10, Drew McIntyre.
Big, gorgeous boy. Also thought I was also first time I met Drew McIntyre was that ICW show where I was in drag for the Jackie Polo segment, and he was doing this was his big return. So I went down. So it was me, Jackie Polo, DCT, and someone came to get us, and we went down to this wee secret bit. And this is where the Still Game guys were at. So we're talking to Still Game guys, and as soon as I walk in here, we're like, all right, darling, how you doing? I turn around and there's this giant monster of a man. And it's just Drew McIntyre. I was like, all right, Drew, how's it going? Nice to meet you.
I love hearing Drew stories because he's so bloody nice.
He's lovely.
Because I've probably mentioned it in podcast because I have like 5 stories when it comes to wrestling. But I've met him twice. And the first time I was security at a signing. I don't know what I was going to guard him against because I'm like a foot shorter than him. And
I don't think he needs guarding.
I don't think so, no. And I got a picture with him and he was very nice. Unfortunately, my phone was like a potato, so the picture itself looked awful. And then the second time I met him, I was backstage. It was Rock and Wrestle shows and I was dropping off Rob Terry, I think. Rob Terry, a big massive guy in a Clio. I picked him up in a tiny Clio 1.4 thing. Anyway, I walked backstage and there he was with his future wife. And he went, oh, how are you doing? I was like, what are you doing here? First question, how are you doing here? So, oh, I'm wrestling tonight. Why? Anyway, so it's just, and he's also the guy, he follows me on my personal Twitter again. No idea why. And then I messaged him after he won at WrestleMania and he replied back. And I'm like, you're the WWE champion. You shouldn't be messaging me back. Just stop it. Stop being so nice.
He's never beaten Matt Daly. they had a match and I think it was ICW. Like the vehicle broke down or something like that, so they were stretching for time, and he was having like impromptu matches. So he had one with Coach. I think it was Coach Strip, and McIntyre beat him straight away, and then Daly came in the ring, but as like in the ring crew, because he just came in and he went, I'll challenge you to a match for ICW belt. And Drew battered him, but it never had an official finish. I'm waiting at this Rumble after he destroys Goldberg. Matt Daly's music's going to hit and he's going to come in and batter McIntyre for that belt.
To be 9 to 5 though. It comes out working man's
club. Yes, man. I was sure that, like, because we were in the big group chat about WrestleMania, and I was like, can you prove that Matt Daly's here? And he's not like in Orlando. A bit the jump, like, and then Big Show popped out in the first. But I was like, "No, it's just Big Show." Sorry.
the thought of it. But no, it's just like one of the nicest guys that I've never heard a bad story recently at all about Drew. So it's so nice that he's representing us, and hopefully batters Goldberg because.
Oh please. Please, I may just be up for wrestling if Goldberg batters him.
Oh man, I'm going to stay up for the Rumble, but I'll be so sad. I'll be so sad if Goldberg wins. Anyway, right.
If wrestling's done, if that's the case.
Yeah, it's over. It's cancelled. Right, I've kept you long enough this evening. So, where can people find you on social media? I know you have a Twitch channel, so you can plug that and anything else you want in this bit.
Right, so you can. So I've got a Facebook page under Manlon, but I don't really update it. I probably should update a bit more. You can follow me on Twitter over at Oh Look It's Manlon. I've also got an Instagram that I've not used in about 3 years, which I probably should try to use a bit more. But you can find me over, my main one is Twitch, which is that Manlon guy. And again, over on Twitter, oh look, it's Manlon.
Excellent. Well, thank you for taking the time to speak to me. And thankfully, we got there eventually after our mishap trying to record this earlier. I've loved this chat, and thank you for taking part.
Well, thank you very much for having me, Billy.